And joining us now to weigh in on the Lacson-Sotto tandem is Professor Edmund Tayao of the Ateneo School of Government. Professor Tayao is also the Executive Director of the Local Government Development Foundation. Professor Tayao, nice to see you again. Thanks for joining us today.
Nice to see you again, Casey, and thanks for having me.
Very interesting discussion we're going to have right now. First off, I want to get your thoughts on the announcement of this Lacson-Sotto tandem. While all of the others have yet to solidify their slate, these two have formed their tandem, have announced, although the official announcement is slated on August 4th, I should say. So your initial thoughts on the announcement first.
I think, Casey, many of those would-be contenders in the coming elections are still finalizing or forming in its final form, their team, their tandem, and even their plans. Many would say probably the announcement of Senators Ping and Tito has been quite early, precisely because the reference has always been in 2016 when President Duterte belatedly joined the list of the candidates running for president. But that's the only thing that they remembered as far as the strategy of a winning candidate like President Duterte. No one must have thought that declaring early, in fact, can be made an advantage. So I'd like to think that the announcement of Senator Tito Sotto and Ping Lacson would be a plus for them. It's as if telling the people that they're willing to be scrutinized and be known for by everyone. Kumbaga, wala silang tinatago. And gusto nilang humarap kaagad sa taong bayan.
So the plus here, not necessarily on their side, but on the people's side, that at least for now, they have one option to think about and scrutinize as early as now.
You could say that. And not only that, perhaps they must have already given much thought and anticipation of some of the issues that may be thrown their way. I mean, for all intents and purposes, these are veteran politicians in the first place.
Yeah, and later on, we're going to talk about some of those issues because you really don't have to dig deep to know about these issues that are surrounding these two personalities. But let me ask you this first before we go into that. What makes this tandem a formidable option?
It's quite early, Casey, to say that it's a formidable in the same way that it's quite early to say that the numbers, as has been seen in the survey that was just recently released, would already reflect how it's going to be in 2022. And in the first place, we're not even sure of the final list of candidates. Everyone has a good chance. I'd like to think that way. And even if we say, for example, that the administration has the advantage, and of course, as always, the administration will always have the advantage for everything in terms of resources, exposure, and everything. But we've also seen how this advantage falter towards the coming of the day of election itself. The president was not even showing good numbers when at the initial part of 2016 elections. It was only towards the end that he improved this consistent number five place in the polls early on.
But numbers aside, though, Professor Tayao, you've got a wealth of legislative experience between these two senators. You have Senator Panfilo Lacson and Senator Tito Sotto. Wouldn't that be considered as really a major factor in making them a viable option in the 2022 elections for the people? Go ahead, Professor.
Of course, you could consider that. But of course, as you know, many of our voters have different considerations in that regard. Even if I'd still insist that You know, especially when it comes to national positions, there's no such thing as bobotante, no? So kaya nga, I'm always inclined to think that marami pang pwedeng mangyari, and not to mention, of course, that at the end of the day, the voters will really look into so many of information that will be necessary for them to weigh and finally make their choice, no, for 2022. So, yeah, isa lang yan yung experience nila sa Senate, no. But we've seen how voters have been making their choices before, and there are just a myriad of options or qualifications or criteria that voters consider.
Of course, now more than ever, we're going to see that voters will really vote on gut issues now more than ever, especially because
Definitely.
Of this pandemic, right?
Yeah.
So what is it about these two that would make them, you think, resonate with the voters, or vice versa, the voters resonating with them? What can you see there, Professor?
That's a good question. In fact, perhaps that should be the first set of issues, no? That they would like to talk about more than, for example, when Senator Manny Pacquiao, no, started his foray to the electoral consciousness, the first issue that he picked is the West Philippine Sea. It's an equally important issue, but it's not one that's very well identified with his caliber, no, his image as a senator. So it's a good idea for Senator Sotto and Lacson, no, to start weighing in on the pandemic, what they intend to do if they are elected into office, especially that definitely we need to recover from this pandemic. As to how we are going to make sense of how they've worked in the Senate as far as the pandemic is concerned, I don't remember much really that we can consider, because for obvious reasons they are in the legislature,
right.
And I'm not quite familiar if there was anything in particular that they put in the legislative mill, no, for the purpose of addressing the pandemic.
And that's a challenge right there for them, right? They may have a wealth of experience, legislative experience between them. But how do these necessarily resonate with the voters? That, would you think that's going to be a major challenge for them to be, for them to appear to be more accessible, to know, to let the voters know that they know their
I
issues?
Think that's a challenge for everyone. No? But again, as you've rightly pointed out, no, that should be the first order of business for any candidate. That's why I reflected on Senator Manny Pacquiao's choices of issues. He could have zeroed in on the pandemic. Again, also, if the objective was to distance himself from the administration, which is quite difficult to do, because he's always been identified with the administration from day one. But whether we like it or not, now, even if we say that the whole world is battling the same pandemic, the government really could have done a lot more, no, and a lot better job, no, in addressing this pandemic. And therefore, if we think that it would be difficult to criticize the government, instead of criticizing, we might as well offer ways, no, to transcend, not the challenges of this pandemic.
I want to talk about the following issues or the following concerns that may be brought up against the Lacson-Sotto tandem. First of all, that they were silent participants to the way this government ran its affairs, and only belatedly did they express their concerns regarding this government. What do you think of that concern or that issue being thrown at them?
You know, I'm quite actually surprised, no, actually not surprised, but wondering why this is being made an issue, No, because whether we like it or not, the government is our government. And even if you're a senator, regardless whether you're with the opposition or the administration, you would like a government to succeed, especially in a pandemic. Whether enabler or not, in fact, if I would be accused of being an enabler, let's say for the sake of argument, I'm a senator, I would gladly say, yes, of course, I'm an enabler. Because in the first place, there's no reason why not to support in the first place and wish the government ill. Of course, it's an entirely different story to say that they could have offered alternatives, no? And this is what I've been saying all along. If they want to distance themselves, if anyone wants to distance himself with the administration, to me, the clear direction to take is to address the problem of the pandemic, because in the first place, it's not only an issue that's very much the concern of everyone, but also, again, as I've said, there's so much more that the government can do, no? Sustain or not sustain, but to address the problems caused by the pandemic better.
What about Senator Tito Soto's stand on the RH law? Do you think that's going to be a factor here? That's going to be brought up again? Go ahead, Professor.
That's another issue. When the RH law was very much being talked by everyone in the past administration, no one mentioned the Magna Carta for Women's Rights that was passed in 2008, which is, to my mind, a lot more comprehensive, and there's not much really different when the RH law was passed. But of course, the RH law was passed. So if it will be raised as an issue against Senator Tito Soto, then he could probably mention the Magna Carta for Women's Rights of 2008 and not only serve as a reference but also as a an indication that it's a real concern which should have always been focused by the government and the policymakers much early on.
He is also known as the father of the dangerous drugs law. Would you see this, Professor Tayao, as sort of a continuation? If there is this win, if he wins, would you see this as sort of a precursor to a continuation of the Duterte drug war, given that he is considered the father of the dangerous drugs law? What do you think about that?
I'm not pretty sure about that. Of course, I'm sure there will be a difference in management style or the approach of President Soto, Vice President Soto and a President Ping Lacson. No? As to the focus on the issue of drugs, of course, it remains a priority, so to speak, and perhaps a different tact may be considered.
Then what about former PNP Chief Panfilo Lacson, now Senator, becoming President? There are concerns that we may just see a police state under a Lacson presidency. Your thoughts about that?
You know, we've always been, fearing so much of what it is to have to have a stricter government, so to speak, and we supposedly have that now. Honestly speaking, I'm not sure really how much difference it would, no? If only the government will simply make sure that much of these laws are really implemented seriously and more effectively. So I don't think there's an option for any government or for any president to be, to go more than what the law allows, no? And to make the so-called state a police state. I don't think there's still room for that, not only in the Philippines, but in most parts of the world.
Mm. And what about the support of these two to the anti-terror law? We know what is happening now, that being used sort of as a vehicle, as a license as well to red tag under a possible Lacson-Sotto leadership. What do you think is going to happen? Is there a danger of this kind of a situation being sustained under their leadership? What are your thoughts?
As far as the so-called red tagging is concerned, we've seen how it's been as far as the so-called sympathizers of the communists have been in Congress. No? And it's not like, the difference probably is that in terms of propaganda, it has, the government has become more active in its propaganda against the left-leaning or left-identified groups, compared to the previous administrations. But again, if we are going to read the anti-terror law, and I would really hope that so much of our viewers will read the anti-terror law, you will not fail to understand and take note that there's a whole process that's provided for there. No, before any action can be taken against a particular entity or a particular group. Now, again, even if we say that there is a background on the part of Senator Ping Lacson as a chief of national police, and therefore may focus on the same issues as the current administration, the question is if existing institutions or existing legal processes will simply allow him to short-circuit the whole process. Mm-hmm. So all I'm saying is that this whole issue of red tagging and the issue of anti-terror law can be protected. One can be protected from it only by from the very start. You read the law and you arm yourself with what is provided for by the law.
How do you see justice under a Lacson presidency, Professor Tayao? I mean, we know the stories. He was once a fugitive from justice, although he had sound bites before that said he was persecuted. The cases against him, I should say, were thrown out, but he called it that he was a fugitive of injustice. And because of what happened to him and also because of his role in the justice system, how do you foresee justice under a Lacson presidency?
Medyo matagal na rin kasi yan, Keisha. I will have to review that part, no? Because if I'm not mistaken, he was he was chief of police in the late 90s, no? During the presidency of Erapstrada, no? Mm-hmm. And it was also at this time when so many issues like the Curatong Baleleng came out and mm-hmm. So on. And I'm sure this will all be revived and asked of him by the public, and hopefully he can answer, no? Straightforwardly as far as these questions are concerned. Now, how he is going to deal with what kind of criminals he will be dealing with later, I cannot really second guess right now, especially as I've said, no, that perhaps in terms of short-circuiting the process, it's not going to be easy, no, for him to just get his way. There's just so much watchdog, groups out there. And we've seen so much of abuses, not only in this administration, but even in the previous administrations. So we have so much that we have learned already in this regard.
Okay, last two questions for you, Professor. We're living in extraordinary times, and that's to say, the very least of what we're going through right now. What do you think is it about this tandem that could possibly pave the way for rebuilding the country post-pandemic, for the recovery of the economy post-pandemic? What's going for them?
As you've said, they have so much experience in legislation. I hope that they have followed through in, looking at how so many of the policies and programs they have helped to enact have been implemented, whether these have been successes or failures, and what were the reasons for successes and failures. Regardless as to which tandem or who will be president this 2022, it should really be the first of his agenda to really look into how we can recover from this damning pandemic. And again, as I've said, the experience in legislation is one thing, but hopefully they can easily and effectively complete the full circle by effectively figuring out how to run the executive department a lot better.
And finally, would it also be equally important for these two or any other tandem that would succeed this current administration to hold the Duterte administration accountable if we were to move forward, if we were to rebuild and recover post the pandemic and post the Duterte regime? Professor.
I hope so. I hope so, Casey. That has always been the agenda ever since. Every new administration has always been looking back at the previous administration and wanting to find accountability in many of the sins of omissions and commissions. But to be honest, our system simply does not allow the completion of many of these initiatives. I mean, again, if we will be very objective, and I hope that we can be more objective, this administration may have a lot of failures, but it's not like the previous administrations did not have the same, the same level of mistakes. And rightly said, that's what's lacking in the kind of politics and governance that we've had. No, there's always been lack of accountability. Hence, it has always been difficult to move forward.
We have to leave it at that. Professor Edmund Tayao, Executive Director of the Local Governance Development Foundation, government rather, and faculty member of the Ateneo School of Government. Thanks, Professor, for joining us.
Salamat.
Today. Always a pleasure talking to you. Take care.
Yes, thank you.